Hi, Governor. Would you be able to talk about what you saw today? I know you've been on the Big Island for many days since the eruption started.
Well, I just wanted to thank the Pahoa and Puna community. It's very clear that they, you know, are still together as a community, working and helping each other. You know, you see it all across the island. It's really heartwarming to see the support that is coming from all across the state. People helping in different ways to help the Puna community here cope with the current situation. You know, that always is heartwarming. And considering that, you know, we're into the second or third week or so of the event, that sense of community is still strong. And there is many all across the state willing to help in the way that they can.
Where did you visit today? What did you see?
Well, you know, we just came in. I wanted to make sure that I got a current brief. As you know, the event early this morning was a little different. You know, we had anticipated that and we had prepared for the event. It was relatively short-lived, as you know, but clearly the ash and the fallout is still with us. We just want to remind the community and those on Hawaii Island to be safe, you know, to listen to civil defense. You know, they are broadcasting what should be done in this kind of ash-driven event. You know, they should stay tuned, avoid the areas where the eruption is active, and most importantly, be mindful and safe all across the state.
Governor, I know you just landed a few minutes ago, but did you get an update on PGV?
Yes, we did. You know, as you know, we really felt that it was important that we take control of the situation there. I just was briefed by Mayor Kim and Tom Travis, and certainly the plan is being executed as we had laid out. You know, first and foremost was removal of the pentane fluids that occurred last week. You know, we are looking at the quenching activity at the geothermal site. You know, we are continuing to proceed to make that facility safe to the community.
So it's not done yet, and the plugs haven't
yet? It's not done yet. You know, there's still additional work that will be required. You know, we do have consultants that we are talking with around the world, making sure that our current plan is the most effective to mitigate the risk to the community. You know, we are focused on assuring that we can mitigate the risk to the community, but we are wanting to be careful and smart about how we do it.
Governor, that sounds like it's still in the planning process. The injection hasn't started yet for the water?
The injection has actually been has started and has been ongoing now. You know, there are monitoring what the impacts of that injection is. And we are continuing to talk about the plugs and the follow-on activities that's required as part of that program.
So injection for one well, is that right?
Yes. Okay. And, you know, we are looking, as you may know, we flew in that second pump, so we have more capacity should we need to. We thought that it was very important. You know, we have begun injection and we are monitoring the response.
What kind of timeline are you looking at?
You know, we are just making sure that we are doing it in a smart and careful way. You know, I don't want to really put out any hard timeline. You know, we continue to want to make sure that we can mitigate the risk as quickly as possible, but we want to be smart and we want to be certain that we are doing the right things. You know, they have, Tom Travis and the mayor has a great group of scientists and experienced people from around the country and around the world, actually, that they've been consulting to make sure that what we're seeing in the wells and the actions that we are taking is the most appropriate course of action.
Can you speak about the state assets that have been put to work to assist the county and the community?
You know, certainly we have mobilized the National Guard. As you know, I promoted General Hara to a dual command status, and so I was at the change of command ceremony this morning at Pacific Fleet and talking with the Admiral and others, and they have pledged full support of Pacific Command for whatever assets we might be. You know, as you know, we are being proactive, so we are anticipating what the different scenarios might be and being certain that we are prepared, that we have action plans that we would need to be implemented depending on what the outcome is. you know, it's like this ash plume that occurred early this morning. We did anticipate that that would be something that would happen. You know, the geologists had been talking about it for a couple of days. And so clearly we were prepared for that and making certain that we get the information out to the community. You know, we do know that sharing the information, I think Talmadge and Civil Defense have been providing updates to all of you on a regular basis. You know, the mayor is really focused and committed to ensuring that that whatever information we have is shared with the entire community. You know, we thank them for their patience and their perseverance. We know that this event is not over, but we continue to work to keep the community safe. Ask that they stay tuned to Civil Defense and follow directions and suggestions, because you know, that is coming from the experts to keep people safe.
Governor, any transportation update? There's been some discussion of Highway 11 and the damage done to it. Anything further on that?
Well, we have a crew over here on the Big Island working with the county crews, trying to develop ongoing monitoring systems so we can be aware of the status of all of the roadways. You know, we are committed to trying to create as much normalcy as we can. So we want to keep the highways and the roadways open. You know, we have plans for bypass activity should we have to do that. You know, we want to assure the community that the county and the state is working together to make sure that the roads are safe and passable, and most importantly, you know, get to a point that should there be a shutdown, that we have alternatives that we can respond to. You know, and I would like to also remind the rest of the world, as well as the rest of the state, that Hawaii Island continues to be open for business. You know, the eruption site and the lava flows is in a very small portion of the island. The whole west side of Hawaii, Waimea, all around are still full of visitors and residents alike. We want to continue to emphasize to the world that Hawaii continues to be open to business, and as well as the rest of the islands. You know, certainly this event has been a strain on the community, and we would ask visitors and residents alike to stay out of the Puna and Pahoa areas, but clearly the rest of the island is open for business.
Thank you so much. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Thank you all for being here.
Hi, Talmadge.
Good afternoon.
What's the update you have for us?
It's been a very interesting day. Started before, we're 24 hours, so the evening overnight crew picked everything up with the steam explosion, and so they quickly got things together and put the messages out. So we're dealing with that all day, watching the plume, and fortunately it was, you know, as far as it was short-lived, so that kind of went down pretty quick, and then didn't have really a wide impact. And like Hawaiian Volcanoes Observatory has been saying, it's been fine stuff that's been going into the communities, but you know, any bigger debris sounds like it's probably within the park, which is closed for safety's sake, and it's a good thing. So we've been dealing with that, you know, first thing this morning, and you can tell with the slack winds or the light winds, the SO2's been bad throughout Puna. So we've been messaging for that from early this morning as well. So, you know, busy with that stuff. You know, all parts of the activity that's been going on, we keep saying that this event's far from over. And fortunately, no vents opened up today. The Fisher 17 seems to be the only one that's still kind of active, but no real flow from it, and the rest are just degassing. And that's why we've got all this SO2 in the atmosphere around here. Trade should be coming back sometime today, although later. So hopefully we'll get better air quality tomorrow, and you know, schools can resume their activity. So
you know of any injuries so far, either respiratory or any injuries related to this volcanic emergency?
You know, the keeping track of the emergency rooms and the medical centers. They said their numbers weren't, up or anything related to the event. So I think people are kind of, heeding our warnings, going to the right place, either sheltering in place or leaving the affected areas altogether. So continue to put that messages out, the messages for Lower Puna to be prepared just in case that area kicks up again and we're looking at possibly losing more roadways. But right now we're kind of in a stable situation and kind of a good opportunity to get ready for what might be next.
What about Highway 11? Any update on Highway 11 and the cracks?
State highways went in there and they called milling. They milled the road so that there's not much of a, offset. So that road's good. It's being monitored by both, the park rangers up there and the county and the state to make sure if something would happen, we'd pick it up right away. The 4.0 earthquake level earthquakes or the high threes that we had the other day, they've kind of slowed down or stopped. They haven't had any more. I think those cracks might have been related to those earthquakes. This morning's event, I asked them, was there any kind of, of course there was seismicity because of the explosion, but there was no really quakes with them, so nothing was really felt.
Do you have any updates on community meetings, any tonight or in the near future?
No, we felt after Mondays that we probably go down to once a week. Haven't scheduled next week's one, perhaps next Monday. But it's on our minds, and we're pushing out information. Our people are all over the communities. We've been putting out information messages for the Lower East Rift. We've been talking about the SO2, the high SO2, and what they can do down there, and preparations if they need to get out. And then up in the Mauka areas, Kilauea, Volcano area, all the way down to maybe Kurdistan, we've been talking about the possible ash exposures and what they need to do to that. And of course we went out, there was that N92 mass giveaway today, so I think they almost gave out 18,000 masks for people to be prepared. So that was a good project.
Can you characterize the extent of ashfall and SO2 today?
Ashfall light, yeah, pretty light, and just kind of isolated areas. And then the SO2 has been, I'd categorize as heavy, but I guess it's doable. I mean, people could still shelter in place. It's not some kind of evacuation type of situation.
With the increased SO2 levels, yesterday's announcement that you've had to evacuate some people under some pretty sketchy circumstances, and obviously increased cracks in the Leilani Estate. At what point is it too unsafe to allow residents back into Leilani? I know that that's continued at this point.
Well, several factors to that. I know we're starting to run short on being able to provide utilities in there. Poles are kind of coming down, because of the activity that's in there. And so, people kind of depend on that to live, so it's going to be harder for them to live in there. So I think that might be part of the factors that lead to, folk that subdivision getting cleared out.
Any idea what the numbers are like now? Are there still a lot of people that are in the subdivision?
I'm going to try and guess. I think about 20 homes are still being occupied in there.
That's in Leilani?
Yes.
That's it?
And at what point do you essentially require them to leave, or do you ever do that?
I'd say if we're in a situation where it's life or death, we'd have to go in there and get them. But right now, even though we're under a mandatory evacuation, we're not forcing that evacuation.
What about Lani Puna? Anybody there?
That one, we cleaned down. We evacuated that area out because of the activity in the area and heavy fumes in that area. So if you notice, if you get our alerts, you notice that area is in the red level. It's pretty high concentration of SO2.
What happens if people can't go to one of the distribution sites to pick up a mask? Or do you folks have anybody who can bring it to people, maybe the elderly or people who can't get to those sites?
Well, actually, we haven't really, you know, planned for that. There are more masks that are coming available. So once those come in, I think we'll have plenty for everybody. We try to fairly spread it out, one per family member, per household. And so, you know, if we're giving 18,000 away, that's a quite a big chunk of folks for the area.
But if they can't get to physically get to the site, maybe, I guess, what, ask a family member or friend?
Yeah, that they can reach out to family members or friends. And, you know, we've got our Office of Aging has information on where these people reside and so forth, and perhaps we can bring them into the operation so that they can distribute some of that.
Okay. What's the response at the shelter in Pahoa to the higher SO2 readings?
Well, those levels there were enough that they could shelter in place. Yeah, and direction is if, you know, they weren't getting comfort there, that people could leave the area, go to someplace, you know, further up Highway 130 where the air is clear.
What was the level? We heard 2.7 at Pahoa Fire Station. You know,
it was kind of, maybe not the highest, but like probably low twos. Yeah.
And that's red.
That's in the red, yes.
Yeah. Red is one?
Red starts at one, and the scale that we put it on is to, you know, account for the sensitive population. And so at that level, most healthy people can, you know, they can be in that stuff for a while. So, yeah, so sheltering in place, you should be fine.
Tom, coming back to the folks who are still in the subdivision tonight, you're saying 20 houses in all of Leilani, if I understand you right.
Yes.
Are you confident that you know where those people are and can reach out to them on short notice?
The teams that we have in there know which, that's how I get the numbers, so they know where the residents are.
And you've got a system set up, I mean, it'd be easy enough to get them out quickly. How much lead time do you think you need?
It kind of depends on what their situation is. But all along, what we've been doing to get those folks out is just using our messaging and alert system. You know, early on, we were even sounding the sirens to get those guys out of there. So if it needs to come to that, we'll do that.
They're obviously diehards. Do you think you're going to have to go house to house with police or something like that? If that situation happens?
You know, if it gets that, like, it's dire of a situation, you know, like we've had houses already get inundated, and I guess people were observed at the house leaving. So I've always, throughout my career, found out that lava has a way of moving people just by its nature.
The latest number is still, as far as destroyed homes and structures,
So it's like 39 structures, and how much houses, residents?
We don't have a breakdown.
Yeah, okay, so early on structures. It was 20. We know we had at least 26 residents at one time. So
39 structures now.
You mentioned you've sounded the sirens. At this point, all the sirens in that area are still operational, and are any of those sirens close to a point where they could be impacted either by flow or electrical issues?
Yeah, good question. That's something we need to check, because I know one was on kind of the Lanipuna end.
Thank you so much.
Thomas, that reading, the red level reading this morning was, when you say fire station, you mean the old one or the new one?
We now have
old
USGS's documents.
It's the old one. You're talking about the senior center.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Jim, you're going to have to come close.
Hi, Jim. Thank you so much.
You have a soft one. Yeah.
Jim, you know, we've been hearing about the so-called big one. I talked to Janet Babb, and she mentioned that it's more like a series of big ones, big steam explosions. Can you kind of explain that? Because people are expecting the so-called big one.
Yeah. These explosive, at least based on the 1924 experience, the explosions are, it's a series of explosions. They don't build up to a biggest one. They vary in strength throughout the period. 1924 lasted about 2.5 weeks. We've seen two or three of these explosive eruptions so far. The biggest one so far has been the one this morning at just after 4. We haven't had anything but a whisper of an emission since this morning. Yeah.
But this is the first of the steam-driven, because I know Tuesday it was the rock falls.
Well, we're still working that out, but it's become kind of the secondary importance to the fact that these were explosions. And the ones last night were, night before last, were explosions. But as you remember earlier when we had these ash eruptions, they were caused by rock falls plugging the vent, and then the gas pressure would drive them out. So the difference here may be that it's not gas pressure anymore, or maybe gas pressure is working with the steam blast mechanism. So we're still working that out, but the fact that they're explosions is a fact.
But you do believe this is a lava lake meeting the water table? You believe that has now happened?
Well, we've... meeting the water table. We've projected that, yes, the water table, the lava column is probably below the water table. Whether they're interacting to produce the steam is one of the questions we're trying to answer. And that goes to the mechanism. If water doesn't get in the column, it would be difficult to have steam blast explosions. But the evidence is difficult to come by at this point. And so, you know, I mean, it's like we can't quite go into the crater and well and gather the evidence. It becomes dangerous to do so. So we're kind of waiting for the right time to get that evidence. We have a bit of evidence in the ash fall that came out this morning. we've gathered a number of samples from ash in different places. And by the way, the ash fall was mitigated by rain. So the rain kind of didn't allow the ash to go very far. But from the samples, it looks like it's mostly just rock dust, like you would expect out of an explosion.
So nothing big like we saw yesterday?
Well, again, we can't go into the caldera. It's too dangerous at this point to see what else is out there, because the larger pieces will only fall right around Halemaumau Crater. But certainly even in our office, if you look at the webcam, you can see the ash on the, not on the lens, but on the covering. So the ash, you know, certainly was concentrated in the crater in the park. We have a few reports outside the park in Volcano Village of people finding ash on their cars and such. But, you know, just even less than a trace, as we would call it.
How long do you think this could possibly last? I know back in 1924, 2.5 weeks. Do you expect about the same?
Well, we don't have a reason to think differently.
And if you could explain the cooling mechanism, I guess that might stop these explosions.
I mean, how they will. Yeah, I was asked that earlier, and I was trying to remember what the mechanism was. And frankly, I don't remember. Sorry.
Well, there won't be as much steam, I guess you could say.
They sort of die off over the last few days of 1924. The explosion sort of died. The seismicity dropped off. There are many expressions of this activity, and seismicity is one of the major ones. we had seismicity build up to a relatively small explosion yesterday evening. It started building up again before the 4 o'clock one, but not nearly as high as yesterday evening's one. And as we speak, it's currently building up again very slowly. So we, you know, it wouldn't surprise us to get another explosion, probably not. Well, we don't know how big it will be, but we'll find out.
Are you smarter than a fifth grade version? What's the cause of the increase in the SO2, and can you explain what degassing means?
Explain what's degassing?
Yeah.
The magma coming up? The gas is coming out of the magma.
Tell me first, what's the cause, why the increase in SO2?
And the increase... At the beginning of this eruption?
No, this particular... this recent increase, that today the levels are higher and people pulled back. And...
Well, for one, we have a Halemaumau grade SO2 emitter in the middle of a residential neighborhood. So people are going to notice that a lot more than they did when it was in the park. the nearest residential area during trade wind time, say, is, you know, tens of miles away. But, you know, you put it in the middle of Leilani Garden, Leilani Estates, can't miss it. Have a day like today where the winds are kind of slack, it's going to accumulate in that area. But, you know, the thing to remember is that this is putting out as much SO2 as Holly Mountain does normally. So we've effectively doubled the emissions, and it's in two places instead of one.
Much of the attention in the last 24 hours has been up at the summit. Can you talk a little bit about what you're seeing in the lower east part of the rift zone as far as seismicity and inflation, yes, and what you anticipate going forward?
Sure. Lower seismicity remains very active seismically. It's also inflating, basically. The surfaces are rising, and the entire area is extending, you can visualize, you just see it with all the cracks in the roads that are widening. Some of those cracks are on the order of a yard. They've opened a yard or so. Some of those cracks have gas coming out, some steam, but the deformation, as we call it, the expansion and rising of the ground continues at the rate it was before. The lower east rift zone activity does not seem to have been affected by these explosions at the summit.
What does that mean going forward as far as what you would expect for additional eruptive activity in the area? Highly likely based on that, with the continued inflation or deformation, as you said?
Well, we haven't seen any change in the rates of seismicity or change in the surface expansion, inflation, whatever. So I wouldn't expect it, but I wouldn't be surprised if activity ramps up again. You know, we had a nice day of no new fissures, but we've had those before. So I wouldn't be surprised if we got another fissure sometime.
And the lava dike hasn't really moved. The seismicity seems like it's located in pretty much the same area it's been for the last handful of days. Is that accurate?
Yes. The seismicity hasn't moved hasn't moved east of Halekamahina yet. So yeah, but it does seem to be still moving somehow, so maybe it's any wider, not sure. But the GPS instruments right around the end of the intrusion tend to be moving, so they seem to indicate that the intrusion is moving somehow, but maybe not the leading edge.
Can you explain the fissure? Is it fissure A, B, and C?
That was 20. That was the most recent one. And they were small outputs. They were close together, farther apart or farther away from nearby fissures. So we deemed it more illustrative, I guess, to just name them 20 A, B, and C. So 21 is now 20 C because it's very close to 20 A.
So essentially, how many are there? So there's 20.
Well, there are 20.
20. Say 20 and not 21.
Yeah.
Take one back.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Sure.
Thank you.
We have two other experts if you would like to hear from them. I don't know. We're getting kind of long in the tooth here, but we have two experts if you want to ask any questions.
An SO2 update would be great.
Yeah.
Hi, Phoenix Grange from the Department of Health. So today, with the more stagnant winds, we've been detecting SO2 in a wider area. Also, as I mentioned yesterday, the department has been busy working with EPA to establish a monitoring network. So now we have a ring of 10 new monitors around the fissure area, and we're getting data feeds from those right now. So we are seeing modifications in the SO2 levels, kind of spiking in areas and then falling down quickly. We're able to use that for emergency response purposes. Civil defense has eyes on right away, and that allows them to plan and send responders, et cetera, in areas where it looks like there might be emerging concerns.
You told us this morning the highest was 2.7. Mm-hmm. Has it gone that high since?
It has in certain areas and beyond, but for short spikes here and there. We've seen momentary spikes as high as 10 and above.
In what areas?
I can't really remember. Generally, we're still learning where all the monitoring networks are. We did send out some responders in one particular area.
Populated areas, though? You're talking
yes.
Schools?
Not around the schools, et cetera. Downwind of the rifts, along the coastline. We sent some emergency responders down there to take some additional measurements to understand what was
going on. How do the levels compare today versus the past 2 weeks?
I think the SO2 levels are higher than we've seen for a while. Again, I think that has to do with the fact that the air is still, so we don't have the wind moving it away so much. Those conditions are going to be changing already later today, and so we would expect a change in those conditions shortly.
At what point do the SO2 levels go from being uncomfortable for most people to being really dangerous for most people?
So based on the way the county has set those levels, so the level of most importance is the initiation of the red level. So the red level, the way we define that is the time when it affects the whole population, when everyone is likely to have some sorts of effects. And then above that, as this concentration gets higher, that's when we begin to have immediate risks to health and safety. But from a planning standpoint, the county is interested in the beginning of that red level.
The reason why I ask is you mentioned that it had spiked at 10, and I'm just trying to gauge how dangerous it is when it's at that level for general population.
So a very important factor here is how long it stays up. So that we saw a spike, it was there and gone within 15 minutes.
That's just shifting winds.
Yes. And so that's really important too, as the county is looking at how they manage these issues, right? If you have a very quick spike and it's gone before people can do anything, you don't want to get the whole community up and moving. So we're learning more, gathering data, keeping our scientists together to be paying close attention, again, to do the best we can to protect the community.
Could you just provide a little clarity about where that spike was, that 10 spike? Because there's a big difference between Lanipuna and the senior center, for example. Is there any way to pin that down?
I'm sorry, I'm having trouble with the place down, the community downwind, Po'oki'i?
Po'oki'i.
Huh?
Po'oki'i.
No, it's not that. It's sounds like
O'pi'ikau.
Yeah, yes. So there were some spikes there in the area between the community and the vents that we were concerned about. We're also using some brand new equipment, and so we weren't sure at first whether or not what those numbers mean, and in fact got a feedback from the laboratory saying we're not convinced about these numbers, and that's where those high spikes were. Just in case, we acted as if they were high, sent emergency responders down to collect those data.
And what did they find when they went down there? Was it that high?
I don't have that data back yet. I think if they were that high, I would have heard.
Right. No, that's ridiculously high, right? 10 is that's deadly, correct?
It is not deadly.
Okay.
No. So one of the
really
things,
high.
Yeah. So one of the issues with sulfur dioxide is that it really depends on how long you're exposed. So there are scenarios at even 100, you can be out there for 15 minutes, right? So it's how long it's affecting your body and your systems. So we are very concerned. We don't want anybody in the public to be even at 5. But we are, you know, a lot of it has to do, again, with that exposure time period. Also, our monitoring network, we're just trying to be as conservative as we can with that information.
Can you speak about the long-term impacts of SO2 exposure? Are there any long-term impacts, or is it just an immediate impact while you're in an area where with a high concentration?
To answer that, I would ask our our medical toxicologist, who is my expert in this area. Can you help me out with that?
This is Dr. Albrostein.
Yes. Hello. Hi.
Hi.
Well, it's certainly, we categorize exposures as acute and chronic. So right now I'd say we're acute. And if a chronic low-level exposure, for instance, you know, for a long, 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 long period of time, could cause some issues, but I'm not expecting that right now with the way the winds so rapidly shift, and I don't think that's a problem at this point.
Doctor, today was excessive SO2 levels combined with the ash. I mean, has this been one of the worst days when it comes to respiratory for this part of the island since this began?
Well, I would been with the paramedics today, and they have not had increased calls, and I haven't heard of increased people getting sick. It's possible that it's going on, and I don't know about it. I think the problem with today is it's kind of socked in. It's got some rain. It got the low clouds, and as soon as this changes with the trades coming back, all this should remit, and it should get a lot better. And we don't have any ash here in Hilo. I'm not seeing any ash. You don't see any ash. It would be pretty obvious, and so I think we're okay from that standpoint.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, Dr.
Thanks, everybody.